Welcome to Intel's XPU and software briefing. We'll share with you a number of exciting milestones on our XPU and hardware software first journey today. Before we start, I have a reminder. Today's event includes forward-looking statements. All statements made that are not historical facts are subject to a number of risks and uncertainties, and actual results may differ materially. Please refer to Intel's most recent earnings release, Form 10Q and 10K SEC filings, available at our website, intc.com, for more information on the risk factors that could cause actual results to differ. Now, without further ado, let me welcome Roger.
Hello, and thank you for joining us today. Just a few months back, during Architecture Day 2020, we shared with you the progress we made across our six technology pillars. You've seen us detail our technology and architecture roadmaps across transistors, 2D and 3D advanced packaging, compute architectures for CPU, GPU, AI, and FPGA, new technologies across the memory hierarchy, interconnect solutions ranging from microns to miles, our disciplined security roadmap, and also our pipeline of software technologies. We also shared with you our vision of future client and data center computing. As we promised at the Architecture Day, we said we will be rolling out several products that leverage these six pillars over the next 12 months. You have seen us keep our promise with the recent launches of Tiger Lake and Xe Max products for consumers. Today, we have some exciting updates to share with the data center users. Before we get into the details, first, let me remind you all again about the journey we are on at Intel. We are going through a major transformation across design, architecture, and solution space. We are transforming our design methodologies from tightly coupled transistor design to a transistor-resilient design, giving us the flexibility to leverage the most advanced IPs and technologies, both internal and external. On architecture, we are on a journey from CPU to XPU. Our CPU architecture has built Intel, and it also played its part to enable the entire world of computing. But we know that the workloads have evolved, and we are striving for mastery over additional XPU architectures that are super efficient for graphics, media, AI, memory, vision, security, and networking. And finally, on our approaches to solving problems, we have a wonderful history of delivering breakthrough hardware architecture and technology innovations, and then bringing the software ecosystem along. We now live in a time where software is running the world. And we are going through a massive culture and mindset change in order to shift to a software-first approach to hardware architecture and design. Today, you'll see the first fruits of our CPU to XPU and software-first initiatives in product form. Xe architecture is foundational to our XPU strategy, and oneAPI is the essential software foundation to enable 20 million developers productively across our XPU architecture. We are looking forward to sharing some exciting updates on our hardware and software products that leverage Xe and oneAPI today. Let me do a quick reminder of our strategy with Xe hardware architecture that we shared with you before. The first key focus with Xe is, not surprisingly, software. We knew that GPUs need a robust software ecosystem to succeed across graphics, media, and computing. For computing, we were fortunate to have a great starting point with Xeon and x86 CPU stack that we built over several decades. We support a rich ecosystem of parallel languages, libraries, and tools. For graphics and media, we have a 20-year history of supporting industry-standard APIs across Windows and Linux. So our starting point is to architect Xe to take advantage of both these foundations. The second focus area was scalability. The XPU market has many segments at many price points and performance levels. Coverage of multiple segments across millions of users is very important for an architecture to get traction with software developers. This is why integrated graphics is so important to our strategy, as it reaches hundreds of millions of users every year. We got great feedback on our Tiger Lake XC launch from a very happy developer community. The third focus was new and emerging workload areas. While building products that are great at current workloads, we also wanted to solve problems that the current solutions are not yet addressing. This will help us differentiate and also provide great choices for users. You first heard me talk about our XE architecture in 2018, which is a single architecture that can scale from teraflops to petaops. We initially started with two microarchitectures. At Supercomputing 2019, we announced our third microarchitecture, XE-HPC, optimized for AI and HPC workloads. And most recently at Architecture Day in 2020, we disclosed that we were well into development of the fourth microarchitecture, XE-HPG, to address gamers. Let me give you a quick execution update across all our microarchitectures. We always said our first step to our product strategy was XCLP. This is the foundation on which we built the rest of our roadmap, and it's what drove our integrated graphics for Tiger Lake and delivered 2x the graphics performance from prior generation. We are super proud of the launch of 11 Gen Core processors in September, and we'll keep raising the bar on integrated graphics. Last month, we launched our first discrete GPU in more than two decades, the Intel Iris Xe Max, along with deep link technology. We focused on all important mobile creator segment. Our new Intel deep link technology brings together both Xe processing engines under a single common software framework to enable workload optimizations. Every bit of performance matters a lot in the constrained mobile form factors. XE-HPG is for gamers, and we are happy to report that the first GPU based on this architecture successfully exited our PowerOn labs. XE-HP is our first data center scale GPU, and is also our first multi-tiled, scalable, and high-performance architecture. We demonstrated this GPU at our Architecture Day, delivering over 40 teraflops of general-purpose FP32 performance and media streaming capabilities that will enable our customers to disrupt form factors for media racks in data centers. Ponte Vecchio is our first XE-HPC-based XPU. This is our most ambitious project that combines many advanced technologies across all our six pillars. We have successfully released the first revisions of all chiplet designs to manufacturing and are eagerly awaiting their arrival to PowerOn. Now back to products, XE, oneAPI, and more. Joining me today are Jeff, Lisa, and Lynn, who will share more details and their excitement on these products.
Hello, I'm Jeff McVeigh. I'm here to talk to you about oneAPI. So as Raja was describing, it is really an amazing time for the diversity of workloads that we have in front of us. And all of those require diverse set of architectures. The challenge from a developer standpoint is that all of those architectures are not supported with the same languages, libraries, and tools, which makes it very difficult to be able to reuse code and be productive across those architectures. The CPU today is the most broadly used and adopted architecture with software. And as new architectures come to life, wouldn't it be great for the software that's already existing on the CPU to be able to be brought to those architectures seamlessly and to provide with full performance? That is exactly what oneAPI sets out to do. It provides a low-level abstraction layer into the software stack that allows for freedom of choice across architectures, as well as breaking developers from the barriers of proprietary programming models and libraries and tools. It does this through a number of ways. One is to provide a language that is cross-architecture as well as cross-vendor that's built on standards and is open for anyone to implement. We call that Data Parallel C++. In addition, oneAPI provides a set of optimized libraries that focus on different domains, from deep learning to math to threading to video processing, and bringing those together so that a framework like TensorFlow or PyTorch or a media framework like FFmpeg can utilize those libraries and language and allow for applications and services on top to basically flow through that architecture extremely effectively without requiring new code development, new tooling, or being locked into a proprietary solution. And what's really critical for this is being an industry open initiative for any vendor to utilize and to deploy so that those capabilities can be brought and exposed to the developers on top. We've been working on oneAPI for a few years, and just last year is when we brought out it from a public standpoint with the industry specification at Supercomputing 2019. Since then, we've been working very closely with partners from the ecosystem to understand the requirements, evolve what the needs are, redefine and improve the APIs and language capabilities, and bring those out with successive generations of the specification, which as of September of 2020 is now at its 1.0 capabilities. And we'll continue to advance it. It doesn't stop here. It continues to be improved, enhanced, taking in the feedback from what's needed from the developer community. A key part of oneAPI is the language that allows for unified programming across architectures. We call this Data Parallel C++. This is built on the SQL standard from Kronos, which evolves from OpenCL, adds significant enhancements, single source support, advances for all the most popular and recent ISO C++ capabilities, as well as enhancements that we continue to help and drive back into the SQL standard so that that becomes truly a robust, high-performance, cross-architecture solution that is fully standards adopted and driven by the industry. And I'm really excited that there's a new book now available in publication. So for anyone that's new to either SQL as well as Data Parallel C++ can fully understand the new language and utilize that to deploy applications across architectures. In addition to the language and the book publication, there's also been lots of advancements in the overall ecosystem in terms of moving forward the capabilities that oneAPI provides. Argonne National Labs is developing one of the world's fastest supercomputers that will utilize oneAPI to be able to program across CPUs and GPUs. The University of Stockholm is actively working on the Gromax application utilizing oneAPI. University of Heidelberg is one of our recent centers of excellence that is now bringing support for Data Parallel C++ to AMD GPUs. And CodePlay previously brought those same types of capabilities to NVIDIA GPUs. So you can see it's really a full breadth of architectures and applications that are enabled by oneAPI. And we're also very excited to announce that the University of Illinois is a new oneAPI Center of Excellence that will be focused on the key workload of NAMD utilizing those capabilities. In addition to the Centers of Excellence and those key workloads and bringing that out across other architectures, we're excited about the endorsements that we've received recently from the TensorFlow framework, utilizing the oneAPI libraries to support CPU and in the future GPU deployments, as well as Microsoft Azure, utilizing and seeing the value of a cross-architecture, open, cross-vendor solution to enable their users to get full performance and capabilities. So as all of that exciting progress has been made with the specification and the industry adoption, we've actively been working on an implementation of oneAPI as a product. And this will be released as the Intel oneAPI Gold coming out in December of 2020. This implements the language, Data Parallel C++, as well as the compiler for that, and all the libraries included in the specification. A hardware abstraction layer that provides peer-to-peer communication, memory management, error handling, and other low-level functions. A compatibility tool, which is really critical for taking source code implemented in CUDA to Data Parallel C++, so then developers can continue to enhance that code base forward. And finally, a set of key analysis tools that allow for performance optimization, as well as the best way to partition workloads between the architectures. On top of these lie all the popular frameworks and runtimes that are powered by oneAPI, and then the applications and services layer on top. So how we're bringing the oneAPI product to market is through a set of toolkits. The first one is really the most foundational one. We call it the base toolkit. This provides the core libraries and tools to allow you to do cross-architecture development of applications, frameworks, and middleware. It provides that compatibility tool to go from CUDA to Data Parallel C++, language support, building upon C++ for the Data Parallel C++ language and compiler, as well as optimized Python, a set of domain libraries covering math, parallel runtimes, artificial intelligence, video processing, that really enable developers to quickly get the best performance and cross-architecture support. And then a familiar set of analysis and debug tools that have been enhanced to support multiple architectures. VTune for performance tuning, Advisor for partitioning of your workload, and GDB for debugging across architectures. In addition to the base toolkit, we have a series of domain-specific add-on toolkits that are targeted at different developer types. The HPC toolkit, as the name implies, is for high-performance computing. It includes the C++ compiler with OpenMP support, Fortran compiler, cluster checker, MPI libraries, and other key capabilities necessary for deploying HPC applications at scale. The IoT toolkit really enables developers that are deploying on the edge and in network the devices necessary for power-efficient performance. These include, again, compilers, Eclipse integrated development environment, as well as connectors to bring together the various platform capabilities. And then finally, the rendering toolkit is utilized for advanced visualization, as well as digital content creation for accelerated ray tracing, image enhancement, denoise, and to support for all the necessary capabilities for rendering of highly complex mathematical models, as well as imagery and video content. And finally, we bring forward a set of toolkits that are powered by the capabilities of the base and domain-specific toolkits. One is focused on data scientists, including powerful and optimized deep learning frameworks, as well as the OpenVINO toolkit, fully optimized and targeted for deployment of inference from client, edge, and data center. So we are bringing all of these toolkits to market as freely available solutions for developers. The base toolkit, the domain-specific add-ons, as well as the powered by oneAPI capabilities. But if there's customers who prefer commercial support, we've got you covered too. We are transitioning Intel Parallel Studio XE, as well as Intel System Studio, to the oneAPI toolkits with a full commercial support offering worldwide capabilities. This allows existing customers to use all of their familiar capabilities and now enhance those with cross-architecture support provided by oneAPI. I've been talking a lot about slides and theoretical capabilities of bill of materials of what's all in oneAPI. Let's talk about some real examples now and to get into a few demos to see it in action. The first is an example of taking user-generated content, needing to transcode that in the cloud for streaming to a mobile device. FFmpeg is a very familiar and popular framework for doing video processing. And within FFmpeg, a media plugin is used to interface to different devices. By utilizing the oneVPL or video processing library as part of oneAPI, it allows for that FFmpeg solution to provide accelerated support across CPU as well as GPU. The application that utilizes FFmpeg need not worry about how that is handled underneath. The magic of oneAPI is providing that solution, but it allows for that capability in a very seamless manner. In a similar way, let's look at some actual code from OpenVINO, which utilizes the lower level libraries of oneAPI to allow for this application of doing image detection and recognition of a video stream. In this demo, using OpenVINO, powered by oneAPI, we are running an object detection sample on a Rode video using SSD MobileNet. And here it is running on a CPU. And on the right side, you can see that we are editing the same sample. By changing the device target from CPU to XeHP, we are now running the same sample, the same code, on an XeHP GPU. The reason we can run the same code on different devices is that oneAPI provides base libraries that frameworks, like OpenVINO, call to abstract underlying hardware. For example, oneVPL accelerates video processing in code and decode, and oneDNN, neural network library, is called by the OpenVINO inference engine to accelerate inference. This is an example of how frameworks built on oneAPI can be portable across vastly different accelerated computing devices, different architectures, different generations, or even different hardware vendors. Okay, so now let's look at an example where ZIB took their commercial application, EasyWave, a tsunami simulation, utilizing the oneAPI product, in particular the compatibility tool, to port the implementation in CUDA to data parallel C++, and then run that same data parallel C++ code across a variety of architectures, Xeon CPU, Xe GPU, Stratix FPGA, as well as back on the NVIDIA GPU. And for this example, the university was able to achieve 95% of the performance using data parallel C++ on NVIDIA platforms relative to the original CUDA source. So this really shows you the value and the capabilities of a cross-architecture solution to provide productivity as well as performance. So all of these toolkits are available freely, broadly, for deployment within your local development environment. You can download them onto your system, you can access them through repositories, as well as we provide a container portal for the oneAPI toolkits, as well as additional workload and other capabilities. In addition to doing that locally, we've also opened up the Intel DevCloud for developers to remotely access the capabilities that oneAPI provides. Within that DevCloud, we make free available access to our critical hardware, Xeon processors, our Aria 10, Stratix 10 FPGAs. I'm very happy to announce that we now have the Intel Iris Xe Max discrete graphics broadly available within the DevCloud, as well for select users, our new XeHP discrete GPU. These provide a full breadth of diverse architectures to utilize, try, and learn oneAPI on top of. The benefits of the DevCloud are hopefully very obvious within this world of remote access, remote work, remote play. Takes literally less than a minute to fill out the registration form, get immediate access, and start coding. You don't need to acquire, install hardware, or the software itself. We provide a rich set of tutorials and samples, including Jupyter Notebooks, VS Code integration, and really allows you to a sandbox to build up your knowledge base on oneAPI, to get started quickly, and then to grow that for full deployments going forward. So we've seen a lot of PowerPoint now. oneAPI is a lot more than PowerPoint. It's running real code on real hardware. And I'm really excited to show for the first time the critical workload known as NAMD, molecular dynamics simulation, that's being used today to fight COVID, running on our XeHP architecture. NAMD, one of the most widely used life sciences applications, is a highly scalable molecular dynamics open source program designed for high performance simulation of large biomolecular systems. The original CUDA code has been ported to oneAPI. Using a dataset from Jordan Kalstead and others at the University of North Dakota, in collaboration with Texas Advanced Computing Center, we used an XeHP GPU to calculate the body's cellular signaling properties of calcium, which when disrupted has been linked to Alzheimer's, cancer, heart disease, and diabetes. Texas Advanced Computing Center utilized the visualization app, VMD, with Intel's oneAPI rendering toolkits, Osprey Renderer, to visualize the molecular interactions with high-fidelity ray tracing that enable scientists to gain deep insight into these biological processes of calcium. So that was really exciting. As you can see, NAMD running on the XeHP architecture shows you that oneAPI is real, running real codes on real hardware. And I hope you're eager to learn more. And you can do that at some upcoming events just in the next few weeks. One is the oneAPI Developer Summit, November 12th and 13th, as well as a number of activities at Supercomputing 2020. Virtual demos, fireside chats, lots of training information that cover all the aspects of oneAPI and how you can utilize that for your cross-architecture deployments. We've covered a lot here today, but I'm really excited about some of the news we're bringing forward. One is the gold release of the oneAPI product in December of 2020, the commercial toolkits, which transition from our existing Parallel Studio XE and System Studio with full commercial support, the new Center of Excellence with the University of Illinois working on that critical workload that we just covered and demonstrated with NAMD, the endorsement from Microsoft Azure, as well as the expansion of the Developer Cloud supporting an ever-increasing set of architectures and solutions to allow you to bring forward your capabilities across architecture easily, performant, and without the fear of lock-in from a single proprietary solution. So with that, I'm very excited to hand the microphone off to Lisa Pearce, who will be covering our data center software for our GPUs.
Jeff and Raja talked about one of our team's core strategies for success, which is to scale our GPU stack across our products. The key is one code base. That means we need reuse in our software stack from entry-level graphics all the way up to HPC and exascale platforms. You're seeing this in action already as we currently support one code base with multiple generations of integrated graphics, including our recently introduced Tiger Lake and our first discrete GPU, Iris Xe Max. Now, as we continue to expand our product portfolio, our key focus is on moving towards data center, where this reuse applies to Linux as well. The first step was ensuring a solid foundation of our Linux GPU driver codebase. 2 years ago, we delivered Linux on our GPUs as what I call a bag of parts. We had little reuse with Windows. Our performance on Linux was about 60% of what we delivered on Windows. And we had not embraced the Linux distribution model effectively. We only supported one distribution directly, and that was partially validated. We've been hard at work, and our team has fundamentally shifted how we engage on Linux. We've redesigned our driver to focus on reuse between OSs, and today we have over 60% of code that is common. Performance of our 3D Linux stack is now at 90% of Windows and trending towards parity, and compute has already achieved parity. And we measure ourselves on how quickly and easily the open source community integrates our new technology. Instead of a bag of parts and various repos, we deliver three fully validated and integrated distro-ready stacks. And our support of the open source community has continued with a focus on ease of access. Over the last year, we've been working on an external portal that provides all the latest information and documentation to get up and running quickly on Linux with our GPU stack. We publish a new release every few weeks, and you can quickly access this info on the site. It shows the distributions that we've enabled and tested, along with the versions for each open source repository that's in that release. To install, click the installation guide, then you pick the distribution you're installing it to. All the instructions we provide are intended to be adhering to the way that that particular OS vendor is managing their system. There is also a technologies page where you can find our key open source component details and how they're enabled, along with key documentation on the design of each. Now, this got us to a solid code base for Linux, which was the first step. Next, we introduced new components to the stack, and the first was level zero, which is key for compute usages. Our oneAPI strategy is to develop consistent hardware abstraction layers, or HALs, for XPUs, which allow higher-level stacks, like libraries and languages, to run on all of our XPU products. For CPUs, the HAL has been defined for over decades and includes core features like thread and memory management, which are leveraged by all OSs. For XPUs, level zero is our HAL. The services it provides are independent of the OS. It allows us to optimize once and use everywhere for various language stacks. It is a direct-to-the-metal way of accessing XPU features like power management, clock control, fine-grained thread controls, among others. And not only is level zero the foundation for key languages in oneAPI like DPC++ for compute, but we're enabling it for rendering usages as well. This is where we broaden the large set of languages already enabled on Xeon today and ensured our critical libraries and languages work across all of our IP, from CPUs to GPUs. ISBC and Osprey are one example of that synergy. Currently, they are the backbone of our rendering toolkit, powering most major studio Xeon-based rendering farms. And we're making them available also on Xe GPUs. We've talked about compute usages and rendering usages, but we have not forgotten about gamers. Our Windows stack has benefited from over two decades of game enabling and tuning, and we're applying all of those best practices to Linux as well, by focusing on the full stack, tackling the tough problems that we know gamers and integrators face. Project FlipFast is one example of that focus. It is a client game streaming stack where the big challenge is supporting multiple guest OSs, where each is running its own game application. We built the system out of standard components, and we found that the performance was being lost by copying data between the guest environment and the host streamer. So we enabled zero copy transfers between all VMs. This FlipFast stack drives significant increases in gaming performance for client usages, and this technology will directly apply to data center gaming streaming applications as well. This is an important first step in improving Linux gaming, and we'll be just getting started, so stay tuned for more updates to FlipFast. So preparing the software infrastructure for XPUs in the data center is a large investment. And for that to make sense, we need to be smart and leverage investments from integrated GPUs to discrete GPUs, from client to data center, but this also includes bringing the rich set of tools and languages from Xeon to GPUs as well. But at the end of the day, all of this effort is all about delivering value to our customers, and for that, we need a platform to run on. So with that, I'm excited to introduce Lynn to give you an update on our GPU data center platforms.
With all the tremendous investments Intel has made in media software, this is a critical foundation to deliver leading solutions for over-the-top media and cloud gaming. Digital content continues to grow dramatically, creating unprecedented opportunities for cloud service providers and communication service providers to offer new services. This is nowhere more evident than for cloud gaming and streaming media. According to the Cisco VNI report, video will account for 82% of the global IP traffic by 2022. Live video will increase 15-fold from 2017 to 2022 to reach 17% of internet video traffic. Over that same time period, gaming traffic is expected to grow 9-fold. In response, new participants are coming to these market segments with companies such as phone manufacturers and OEMs joining along with cloud and communication service providers to vie for consumer attention. In fact, the game development ecosystem is increasingly focused on Android, with more than 74% of the global mobile market share. To deliver these new services in an affordable way, it necessitates a new set of requirements for both software and hardware. The key challenge is how to deliver the right performance levels while still keeping infrastructure and operational costs low at the responsiveness users demand. That's why we're delivering a rich suite of platform innovations, including server graphics technologies. With a combination of Intel Xeon scalable processors, open-sourced and licensed software ingredients, and our new Intel Server GPU, our customers can now provide high-density, low-latency Android cloud gaming and high-density media transcode and encode for real-time over-the-top video streaming. To deliver incredible experiences for their users, service providers can achieve a large number of streams per card for a smaller data center footprint. What really stands out about this hardware and software solution is its ability to achieve low total cost of ownership for service providers. High performance per watt helps drive total cost of ownership down by reducing OpEx. And the Intel Server GPU helps reduce CapEx associated with both equipment and facilities costs. An optimized software stack supports the Intel Server GPU, drawing on a broad ecosystem and generations of innovation. Standards-based open-source software ranges from drivers and APIs to developer tools such as the Intel Media SDK, streamlining development while also optimizing code quality, as well as the Mesa 3D Graphics Library, an open-source implementation of OpenGL. The Intel Server GPU supports accelerated AVC, HEVC, MPEG-2, VP9 encode decode, and AV1 decode. An optimized media plugin for FFmpeg, the widely used industry standard open source framework for video streaming applications, enables application compatibility across Xeon scalable processors and the Intel Server GPU. For Android cloud gaming, Intel licenses additional software components that work with the game streaming solution to support high server game stream density, game performance, and breadth of gaming title accessibility. These software components include Android in container solution for games running on Intel-based platforms, helping enable high stream density. Intel Cloud Rendering software provides the core cloud rendering technology and leverages the Intel-optimized Mesa 3D Graphics Library to optimize Intel Server GPU utilization. Finally, the cloud gaming software stack can take advantage of Intel Bridge technology, which enables certain Android applications not written in Java or compiled to run natively on Intel-based devices such as Xeon to run on those devices. This software, combined with an optimal Intel-based server configuration, provides a strong foundation on which to deploy an Android gaming service. The Intel Server GPU is based on a low-power discrete system-on-chip design with a 128-bit wide pipeline and 8 gigabytes of dedicated onboard low-power DDR4 memory. Four server GPUs are packaged together in a 3/4 length, full height x16 PCIe Gen 3 add-in card from H3C, with a target configuration of up to 4 cards per server. By using Intel Server GPUs alongside Intel Xeon scalable processors, data center operators can scale graphics capacity separately from server count, supporting larger number of streams and subscribers per system.
Now let's see how the GPU performs. Arena of Valor, created by Tencent Games, is one of the most popular mobile games on the market today, and it demands incredible performance. This application is run on mobile platforms, similar to the one that you see here. What makes this GPU stand out is its flexibility to also scale to many game streams at the same time. Now you can see that I have a server next to me, and it has the H3C XG310 PCIe card that integrates 4 Intel Server GPUs. I'm going to start streaming instances of Arena of Valor from this card. You can see that each of the GPUs on these cards are streaming 15 streams per GPU for a total of 60 streams per card in flawless 720p at 30 frames per second. Now, this is great, but we can provide further stream density by adding additional Intel Server GPUs to the system. When 2 cards are used, you can see we are able to stream 120 simultaneous users, and we're still maintaining 30 frames per second. This is just one example with the game Arena of Valor. Typically, the H3C XG310 card can support greater than 100 simultaneous users in a 2-card system that includes Intel Xeon scalable processors and up to 160 simultaneous users, depending on the specific game title and server configuration.
We have many software and services partners launching our solution, including Tencent Games, that is introducing their new Android cloud gaming service. Alan Feng, Vice General Manager of Tencent Cloud Gaming, talks about their success with our solution.
5G 时代云游戏 将是下一个潜在的高增长领域，这对作为全球游戏领导者之一的腾讯具有战略意义。其中最重要的是低成本、高密度、低延时的云游戏解决方案，该方案可支持大量用户使用，而不会降低用户体验。英特尔至强可扩展处理器搭载含四个英特尔服务器图形处理单元的新华三 XG310 PCIe 加速卡，同时具备来自英特尔及综合生态系统合作伙伴的整套软件站、软件开发包，为用户提供高密度，每个双卡服务器支持超过100台王者荣耀、传说对决、低延时、低功耗、低成本的云游戏解决方案。
With today's announcements, we have completed our XELP microarchitecture roadmap for 2020 with three products available to the market. Today marks some of the first monumental steps in this journey towards XPU architectures. This enables more meaningful experiences through our six pillars of technology innovation and heterogeneous architectures, and provided through an open standards-based, unified scalable software abstraction layer.With our heritage in media software, we're delivering software and hardware that solves customer pain points today. And moving forward, our investments in video extensions to oneAPI will result in even greater developer access to new advancements in Intel media to unlock hardware value. Intel is proud of our commitment to bring our customers world-class hardware and software so they can conquer the digital world. Thank you for spending your time with us today.